It's always exciting when you discover a new kaiju film that you had no idea existed. At least that was my experience with Underwater. Set presumably in the near future, a corporation drills into the deepest part of the ocean, the Mariana Trench, when unexpectedly an uncontrollable force wreaks havoc on the drilling station. Before we go any further, this will be a spoiler review. So where do we begin? First of all, this movie looks great. I can't say it looks gorgeous because it's dark and dreary for most of the movie, but even with that being said, there are still some beautiful imagery and scenes. You can really see the concept art come to life in some moments. Sets are immersive and wonderfully constructed. I felt the claustrophobia and was thankful that I actually wasn't underwater. Despite the murkiness of the deep sea and a drill station that looks like a bland prison cell, in a good way, the director does a great job of giving the audience a sense of direction in the darkness. There are a few brief couple moments where it becomes difficult to understand where the characters are headed on the seafloor, but that might be intentional, as I feel like the characters themselves are lost and we're supposed to catch that feeling. Also, in regards to imagery, every time you see these creepy little parasitic monsters crawling around on the ocean floor, you can see that their eyes are reflecting the little bit of light that they have. That is an amazing image. So besides the plot, what is this movie? Well, the best way to approach this is a Cloverfield movie. Now, it's not a Cloverfield movie, but think of 10 Cloverfield Lane in that you feel the monster's presence rather than see it. Granted, you do see the monsters, but not until later in the film, and you don't get to see the Daikaiju. Yes, there is Daikaiju in this, until the grand finale. The movie relies more on you building your own imagination of what's going on outside. Actually, the resemblance to the Cloverfield franchise is so uncanny. From the parasitic-like offspring to the situation characters find themselves in, I can't help but wonder, why isn't this a Cloverfield film? And especially when you consider the marketing material for the original Cloverfield movie, hidden marketing across the internet was actually implying that Cloverfield was awoken by deep-sea drilling. It was actually security camera images, which would fit in very well with the monster of Underwater. This movie was backed by Fox. But now Disney owns Fox, and it seems like Disney had no interest in releasing this movie, or at least pushing it to its full potential. At least that's the theories that are circulating online. And that's unfortunate, because this movie had so much potential. And if Disney really had that much of a lack of faith in it, then maybe they should have just sold it to JJ and Paramount. Give it an extra year and tweak it and turn it into a Cloverfield film. Another influence on this film is Ridley Scott's Alien and Prometheus franchise. Once again, there's intentional parallels to the first chestburster scene and an alien-like creature trying to feed on humans. The way they treat the ocean like space, and even some of the set designs resembling the art of H.R. Giger. With such common threads, and coupled with the fact that Fox owns both Alien, or at least owned both Alien and Underwater, why didn't they just make this into an Alien film? So if this wasn't enough like Cloverfield, and it wasn't enough like Alien, it's also heavily influenced by Cthulhu. Yes, the main Daikaiju itself resembles Cthulhu to a degree of being a blatant ripoff. Hollywood has struggled to make a Lovecraftian Cthulhu film, and either the director or the writer must have felt like they had something to prove that it could be done. A Cthulhu movie could be made. And between the levels of homage and copying Cthulhu, it makes me wonder, why wasn't this a Lovecraft movie? So yes, about this Daikaiju, we've already discussed that it looks like Cthulhu, and scale-wise, it appears to dwarf Godzilla. Or at least I think it does. It's really hard to get a scale of this creature, mostly because we're in the dark depths of the ocean. But what you can see of the monsters and everything in general, the CGI is handled very well. And it should, because it has a much larger budget than 10 Cloverfield Lane did. And so the journey itself was pretty great. I'm not easily scared by movies, but there's a few jump scares in here, and one of them got me. I could definitely hear other people in the audience reacting to a few jump scares. But the suspense was there, and it left me asking myself, why can't we get a Godzilla movie like this? Now, I understand Godzilla has to be on screen a lot more than Underwater or Cloverfield, but if we could just get a reboot or a standalone Godzilla movie where it's just Godzilla wrecking havoc, hiding in the debris and stuff, kind of like Gareth Edwards had, and just make it suspenseful, that's what I want to see. But enough about Godzilla here. Well, okay, one more thing about Godzilla. I did notice that some of the suspenseful scenes here in Underwater seem to be very similar to two of the most recent Godzilla films. The very first moment of suspense in the movie seems like it was taken right out of Godzilla 2014, specifically regarding trapping people on the other side of airlocks, if you recall the Bryan Cranston scene. And not only that, but the climax, whenever the Cthulhu-like monster is being shown. That feels like Godzilla King of the Monsters 2019, whenever they're in the Monarch undersea base and you have Godzilla approaching the big window. That feels like that was a blatant ripoff of that too. However, this movie was actually made in 2017. It's just interesting whenever two different studio companies come up with the same idea around the same time. But yeah, like I said, enough about Godzilla here. Now, I do have some gripes about this movie. Some of the smaller plot details were quite predictable. There is a plot regarding the drill station's chief's daughter. Daughter's not in the movie, but they talk about the daughter. And they kind of intentionally make it obvious that there's something not right about his story about the daughter. Either he never had a daughter or his daughter died. And so we know that. But then later on in the movie, they do this sort of big reveal. It's like, oh, look. Turns out the daughter was actually dead, but we kind of already knew that from an hour earlier in the movie whenever they just made it really obvious. From a storytelling perspective, it seemed like they gave you too many clues too soon, and then they came back to it like an hour later in the movie, so the pacing was way off. Another thing is there was a shelter or another mini base that they point at early in the beginning of the movie on a map. They're like, look, we need to evacuate this drill site. We need to go to here. And somebody points out on the map, oh, what about this one here? And they're like, well, no, we can't go there. It's closed. It's abandoned. And it's like, oh, well, obviously they're going to end up there at some point. So yeah, there was minor things like that were a little bit predictable. And you can kind of guess which characters are going to die, but they're not all that predictable. I still didn't know how anybody was going to get from point A to point B. I just kind of knew some of the stops along the way. Another possible gripe is that actor T.J. Miller is in this. You may know him from many movies. He's been a supporting character in the Deadpool movies. He was even in one of the Transformer movies. He does a decent job in here. He's the comic relief. Most of the jokes are through him. Some jokes come from other sources, including an automated intercom at the drilling station. The jokes weren't too well received. Like, nobody groaned in the audience, but there was nothing more than like a few chuckles. But regarding T.J. Miller, depending if you're interested in this kind of stuff, if you care about an actor's personal life, he's been more on the controversial side. Maybe he's not somebody you want to support or whatever. He's had a history of sexual assault, physical assault, making false bomb threats, and even what can only be described as bullying other actors on set. Perhaps that won't affect it for you, but I know some people truly only like to support movies with respectable actors. That may be a factor, but there you go. So yeah, the movie does set up a sequel, and I doubt that we're going to get one, but at the end of the movie, we have the main character played by Kristen Stewart. She's mostly known for the Twilight saga. She is able to successfully self-destruct the drill site and pretty much kill the Cthulhu knockoff. However, shortly after that, we cut to the end credits and we see headlines from newspapers, kind of like Godzilla 2014 and Godzilla King of the Monsters, just headlines saying that the survivors are being quarantined or their interviews are being classified, and that the drill company is planning to continue drilling at the site despite the fact that the movie implies that the drilling is what woke up the Daikaiju in the first place. Yeah, so as far as acting, it's really well carried overall. There's only one emotion throughout the whole movie, which is panic. Everybody's traumatized. So Kristen Stewart does a great job delivering that feeling, but there's not much else to compare it to in the film. The movie itself runs about 95 minutes and is very to the point. There's no filler. And the only thing left to say is that there's one really rough moment in this movie where it's either an editing mistake or a budget mistake or something. We see the main character, played by Kristen Stewart, walk out on the deck of the drilling rig. The deck is underwater. And she's looking off into the distance, into the darkness. And it seems like something's about to happen, but then the screen cuts to darkness. And then it returns, and she's still standing there. And it's like a whole scene is missing, actually. It seems like maybe they were originally going to show a part of the Daikaiju. And then they said, well, no, it's too soon. I just don't understand why they would even put that pause in there. It's a great visual image of looking out into the darkness and not being able to see anything but dirt and debris floating around. But at the end of the day, a very amateurish mistake right there. Even with me nitpicking and trying to tear this apart here with complaints about T.J. Miller or the editing, or maybe the comedy not being on point. Overall, as a sci-fi film, it's very solid. I would have to rank this at a strong 7 out of 10. However, if you're only here for the monsters, or specifically the giant kaiju at the end, it is a very long wait to get to it. Ask yourself how much you enjoyed 10 Cloverfield Lane before you see this. All right, Monsties, are you seeing this? Did you see it? What did you think of it? Should they have connected this to Cloverfield? Should this be a Cthulhu movie? What should this be? Will there ever be a sequel? Let me know. But it's a nice little movie to hold us over until King Kong vs. Godzilla later this year. However, this is a lot more suspenseful than any Godzilla movie has ever been. So perhaps you don't want to take kids there because they might be frightened. And there's a little bit of language and cursing in there too. There's people in their underwear a lot of the time here, just because they're on the run and they weren't fully dressed. But there's no nudity. So it is safe for older children, maybe teenagers, to go see. But I would hold off on taking the kids. One, because they might be a little bit bored. And two, the suspense might truly give them nightmares. All right, Monsties, thanks for watching.